thanks so much for joining us as our first guest speaker. For me, and I think for much of our audience who are similarly based in the humanities, social sciences, and the arts, I think this is going to be a really illuminating conversation, especially to hear about your experimental work. So not just kind of the results, but also the vocabulary and the outlook and the methodology that comes from a more scientifically informed perspective. So you started out as a musician. Could you tell us a bit about the trajectory of your career and the way that your interests have grown and been shaped? And what do you think, looking back, have been kind of the main motivating questions or impulses behind your work?
Okay. I started off as a musician, performer, I suppose, classical guitar, mainly working with another guitarist in a duo. And that was, I enjoyed immensely. I was asked to teach guitar at a conservatory and realised I didn't actually know very much about music, so I thought I'd better go back to university and study music. I ended up going to City University in London to a very new course, which is a BSc in music, which was great because it was just starting up and it was more or less make it up as you go along. We did maths, physics, psychophysics, free improvisation, ethnomusicology, medieval music, and so on. Very non-trad music degree. In the course of that, I began to realise that I was interested in trying to figure out why things worked. How is it that when you're playing a piece of music, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't? How do you make sense of something as a piece of music? I had heard performances in master classes, for instance, where I just wasn't sure what was being played until about four or five bars in, when it was, oh, it's that! Because it was being played so oddly. What was odd about it? I wanted to find these things out. So in my final year, I did the final year psychology course as well, and I stayed on and did a PhD, focusing on music cognition. I was looking initially at tonal structure. How do we organise music in our heads? And over the last 40 years, that's gradually transmuted into, well, actually, what is music in the first place? What do we mean by music? And for the last 10 years, particularly, the last 20 years, that's been my main theoretical and practical interest. The last 10 years in particular, in conjunction with people from linguistics, I've been looking at how we can explore music as an interactive phenomenon. When we do music together, what's going on?
Interesting, thanks so much. How has your experience, do you think, as a performing musician contributed to this evolution of interest? And do the people you work with tend to be musicians? And is there a kind of informal, adjacent artistic community that shapes and is shaped by the kind of scholarly work that you do with other scientists?
Well, I suppose when I started off, there were very few people working in music departments, very few people who were coming from a music background who were doing experiments and were looking at this, at music from a scientific perspective. That's changed radically over the last 40 years, as you might expect. A lot of people are now coming at music from scientific perspectives, armed with extremely powerful musicological tools and wide musicological expertise and wide musical expertise. Not quite the same thing. You can be an expert musician and not actually know very much about music. And you can be an expert musicologist and not be able to perform. The two are not mutually exclusive, but they don't necessarily couple. But what is happening now is that you've got, let us say, more sophisticated conceptions of music being explored, conceptions that are informed by current humanistic thinking as well as scientific thinking.
You've, throughout your career, dictated and set the agenda for this kind of new field of cognitive approaches to music. And you've operated genuinely in an interdisciplinary space. Mm. And now we're sitting in the Center for Music and Science, which is a literal interdisciplinary space. What do you think has contributed to the successes of the center over the years, and what have been some challenges? And I think this is really interesting for those of us in the humanities who are just now venturing out into interdisciplinary, kind of more hospitable interdisciplinary interactions with the sciences. Sure. And I think have a lot to learn from the way that cognitive and music studies have worked together.
Okay, that's quite complicated. Some of it comes down quite literally to words. Terminology. If I say music, what does that mean? If you say music, what does that mean? If someone in the street says, if you ask, stop someone in the street and ask, what is music? You'll get a range of answers. Typically, it'll be focused on the idea that music is sound, that we listen to it because we like it, and that's about it. Is that what the totality of music, from a musicological perspective? No way. It's much more complex and densely ramified than that, and culturally variable. It's different things in different cultures. The idea that there is music is sometimes contestable, just in the same way that within anthropology, the idea of culture is contestable. In other words, the idea of music is effectively a social construct, or rather, music is effectively a social construct. It's probably other stuff as well. But to say that it's a social construct doesn't mean that it's not real. What we have to do is unpick how it is socially constructed and how it relates to our biological capacities and predispositions. Because we can do music, other species don't seem to be able to. Or let us say, are not necessarily motivated to. That poses an interesting challenge. And some have tried to answer it by saying, well, music just makes us feel good. Well, why? It's a terribly complicated way of feeling good. We could, you know, drugs would be much easier. Or sex, you know, either of those two would do fine. Why go to such trouble and produce something like music, or engage in something like music? Well, I think that's a reasonable starting point to begin investigating what are the underlying factors and features of what we conceive of as music. Are there any, in fact, that are consistent even within a culture, across cultures? Should we be limiting it to a narrow range of phenomena, a wider range of phenomena? All of those factors make this an intrinsically interdisciplinary enterprise. Now, once one becomes interdisciplinary, to go back to where I started this answer, you come up against terminology. Precisely, what do we mean by X, as it were? And a lot of the initial steps in interdisciplinarity are aimed at ensuring we're talking about the same thing, or using the same set of terms, or at least understanding the terms that each of us is using. The other aspect that, as it were, one needs to encounter and embrace is methodologies, because the methodologies that are used within the sciences tend to be somewhat different from those used within the humanities. That is changing. There's more of an acceptance now of the utility of large-scale computational approaches within humanistic disciplines. They need to be informed, just as the application of large-scale computational approaches needs to be informed in the sciences. I've seen a number of approaches which make big claims which really can't be justified. But ultimately, science is a process, just as humanistic research is a process. It's just that the tools you use in the course of unfolding that process tend to be somewhat different, but there's no particularly good reason why they should be. The point about science is that by applying particular methods, it plugs you into a battery of knowledge that has been arrived at by the use of these very same types of tools. And that is acceptable on the basis of the same types of criteria. One has to remember, of course, that there's a good argument for suggesting that there is no such thing as science. There are the sciences. all of which use slight variations on these different tools, make slightly variable claims, but all of which are understandable from the perspective of each other in ways that might not be the case if someone from the humanities were to attempt to make sense of what is going on within any particular science. In other words, science is social practice as much as anything else, and one has to be aware that that is what one is doing and that is what is being done. So that to some extent, scientific knowledge is not just this densely ramified truth, it's also a social construct with variable levels of, well, what could one say? Epistemological certainty, perhaps.
I wanted to go back to what you said about language. So some of the people I've been speaking to who are mainly musicians or people in the humanities also bring up this question of language that is kind of at the core of methodological questions about interdisciplinary practice. And I suspect that I'll get a different answer from you with this. They, and I think I also subscribe to this, to a kind of view that allowing for room or space or a bit of looseness around terms and around language is generally a good thing, and that things like metaphor are really useful things. And to borrow from, for example, really technical language that has different resonances within your discipline that can function as metaphor rather than a kind of tight, identical thing is a good thing. I've heard people speak about a resonance as a, again, another, I guess, good metaphor for this kind of thing. So, for example, there's a chapter on distributed cognition and literature in the early modern period and in the medieval period. And in that, the author suggests that current thinking about 4E cognition has resonances with, for example, humoral thinking or thinking about bodies as porous. And they're not suggesting that it's the same thing, that the bodies experienced were the same bodies, that the language was the same, that the beliefs were the same, but that they seem to line up in ways that are suggestive. Is this, do you think, rigorous enough?
I think it's an interesting way of approaching the issue. There are two facets to it. One is it's a pragmatic approach, in that if one can identify what you might call parallels or metaphorical crossovers, metaphorical mappings, if you like, then one might be able to make inferences that would otherwise not be available. The problem might come if the metaphor begins to reify and concrete and solidify into something that's less fluid than it needs to be to remain a metaphor. If it begins to turn into a stronger claim than is warranted, or if it begins to be used to substantiate stronger claims than would be warranted. Metaphorical thinking, well, yeah, we all do it all the time. We all do it everywhere, in fact. Scientists do it all the time. But it's not just metaphor. That is, there have to be some points of entry that allow for ideas to be deconstructed, to be tested to destruction, to be falsified. I don't subscribe to a strict Popperian criterion of falsifiability for scientific knowledge. I'd actually rather go with Imre Lakatos's notice of sophisticated methodological falsificationism, which he outlines in his substantial chapter, I think, called The Idea of Scientific Research Programs, wherein you science effectively operates by means of the formation and testing of a critical body of theory that begins to become substantive, around which accrete a number of auxiliary theories that support it, and that may be incorporated into the core theory. But if sufficient of the auxiliary theories are knocked out or falsified, then that can begin to undermine the core theory, which can eventually lead to what Thomas Kuhn called a paradigm shift. You just, okay, we need a new way of entirely thinking about this. That rarely happens all at once. It rarely happens to all of science at the same time. In fact, it doesn't happen to all of science at the same time. It happens to sciences. But the notion of but science is a process. So metaphor can play a significant role in that process, in helping you get from A to B. But to mistake the metaphor for the thing that is being metaphorized is an issue.
Do you think that metaphor is necessary, not just as a means to an end or to be used in this instrumentalized way, but because there are things that otherwise are completely inaccessible? So with music, I feel like this is a, maybe for everyone other than people who work with cognitive science and music, one thing that you might hear from people who are on the street or musicians or whatever is actually difficulty about describing music and describing its effects on them and describing how it works. Is there any room for like mystery or enchantment in what you do?
Of course there is, otherwise I wouldn't do it. It's one of the things that people say, but it takes all the mystery out of it. It might if I could work out what was going on, but I can't. So, no, you're never going to run out of questions. Why? I can come up with an idea of what music is, but it's provisional, it's conditional, and necessarily incomplete. And there are always contexts, always issues that you suddenly ask, I wonder what, I wonder if. And that's what keeps you going. Because there's always something else to test, to tweak, to investigate. And sometimes you find, oh my God, I'm, as it were, round the back looking at the workings and I have no idea what's going on. And that's great because you suddenly realize, okay, more questions. Mm. Yeah.
How do you speak to musicians who don't know anything about music?
Well, musicians obviously do know things about music. Anyone who does music knows a great deal about music. They might not be able to express it. They might not know about it in what you might call declarative terms. I've known some amazing jazz musicians, folk musicians, who are, you know, would find it difficult to explain precisely what they're doing. On the other hand, increasingly, the most cerebral and theoretically well-equipped musicians tend to be jazz musicians these days. Mm. What they study in jazz courses and conservatories is just extraordinary stuff. Extraordinarily complicated ways of unpacking something that eventually will seem and feel as simple as breathing. Mm.
I wanted to go over to the kind of specifics of some of your work, if possible. Mm. Could you tell us what floating intentionality is?
Well, it started off as a placeholder. The idea that when we listen to music or when we do music, we know precisely what it's about. It seems to be, it has an aboutness, it has an intentionality. But when we start talking to other people about what it is that the music is about, we lapse into metaphor, or we just can't do it because we can't articulate it. Hence, the music has an intentionality. That intentionality is not relatively fixed in the way that meaning, intentionality in language, tends to be fixed. Language isn't really much use if two people can't determine what they actually mean by a given word. Language loses its utility. But when we do music together, when we listen to music together, we actually don't need to agree upon what it is that the music intends or means. It can just be floating in that sense. So it's really a way of accounting for an attribute of music that does seem pretty much universal and might well be extremely functional.
Is there music that's non-intentional?
I don't know, because if music is human, humans are necessarily intentional.
I want to ask about the non-human and its place in music.
Yeah.
So instruments, though sometimes we do personify them, but also architectural spaces, so whether that be the studio or the concert hall. In thinking about 4E cognition, probably especially embedded or enacted, how do spaces, do you think, and non-human agents figure into the kind of musicking that goes on?
Well, first of all, instruments, I tend to think of them as prostheses. They allow you to make sounds that you couldn't generally make with your own body, unless you practice really hard, or Bobby McFerrin, for example. That's probably the origin, in some respects, of instruments. They just enable you to make sounds, to do stuff that you couldn't do without the instrument. And for someone who uses them a lot, who practices a lot, they become you. So when you make a sound, you're not making a sound, you're performing an action, and that action just happens to produce that sound. You would find it impossible, in fact, to imagine the sound without the action. The sound and the action are probably pretty much the same thing. Spaces. Well, there's been very interesting research recently. Stefan Weinzel and Zora Scherer Kalkandiev, who was a visiting student here a few years ago, did a fabulous paper where they characterised a number of different concert halls around Europe completely acoustically, to the extent that they could replicate the experience of being in a different space in an anechoic chamber. I've got a very, very good cellist, French cellist, to perform the Bach cello suites in the anechoic chamber, flipping between different concert halls. And they looked at what happened in terms of the relationship between certain acoustical attributes of the spaces and physical aspects of the performance. And they found that there was a relationship, which anyone who performs a lot will tell you. You have to do it differently in different spaces. If you're performing in King's Chapel, it's going to be different from performing in Trinity Chapel, because King's Chapel's much bigger. So the reverberation times are a lot longer, so you have to leave a little bit more space between notes. But at the same time, if you're performing something like a cello suite, one of the back cello suites in actually either space would do really, you can just glory in it because you don't need to work so hard. You play, you throw the notes out into the space, you just toss them into the air and allow them to circle. If, on the other hand, you're playing in a nasty, mean little space, like, frankly, many small recital spaces, or multi-purpose venues, that's usually the horrible spaces, where there's no reverberation at all, there's the minimal reflections, then you have to do something different. The tendency is to try and play louder, which really doesn't work, because you're just exerting, you're over anxious. You're forcing the sound. The best strategy is to think, okay, ignore it. I'm just going to play for me, because it's probable that the majority of the audience will hear something reasonable, although it sounds horrible to you. What Stefan and Zora found was that in big reverberant spaces, the performer slowed down. In small, non-reverberant spaces, the performer slowed down. In places in the middle, the performer's a little faster. So there are you can think of the space in which you're performing as an extension of the performer and instrument. So it's a very extended self, because you're being aware of and making use of the affordances of the space, or compensating for them.
When you were talking about instruments, you mentioned that the instruments become you if you have a certain kind of ease with them. Does it work the other way. It's a two-way traffic. So I'm learning the organ now, and my organ teacher, who's an organ scholar, always tells me, become the organ. And I think with the organ, it's much easier to think about it that way, just because when you think about the organ, you're thinking about the whole space, so the whole chapel. It's a chapel organ. And you just realize that you're completely dwarfed and, in fact, contained by the instrument that you're playing. And you realize that the mechanical and hopefully cognitive and artistic function that you're serving is at least in size very small. And I think that's one of the criticisms of extension or extended cognition models is that, they don't distribute agency. They just distribute kind of scale, I guess. So is there room for thinking about an instrument which adopts you as part of it?
I would rather say that instruments offer certain affordances. Some are more transparent than others. With the organ, to some extent, it does what it wants, simply in real terms, because it's this mechanical brute. You cannot make it do things faster than it's capable of doing. With something like a violin, or like a classical guitar, you can do a hell of a lot, simply because the instrument can be responsive in ways. But even then, different instruments will be differently responsive. I have two, I've got a number of guitars, but two of which are by Jose Ramirez, not Manuel, couldn't afford a Manuel Ramirez. One is a concert guitar from about mid-1970s, which is the guitar I've played most of my life, and I love it. It's a huge guitar. It's very tough to play. You've got to work very hard. I have to practice. When I'm playing that instrument, I have to practice 2-3 hours a day. Just stamina, sheerly stamina. I also have a Ramirez Flamenco, which is from the mid-60s, and that, after playing the big Ramirez, is a joy because it plays itself. I don't have to do any work. So there are certain affordances that are encapsulated in one's interaction with different instruments, which allow different, you could almost say, negotiation between you and the instrument. That negotiation is done generally in long-term, long-scale practice. So when you go on stage, it's just you and the instrument. These days, if I perform, I tend to use the flamenco machine because it's I don't have to do any work.
Moving from the non-human to the post-human, I meant to ask you about algorithms and new modes of listening and encountering music and what it is that they lack, I guess, and what it is that they maybe kind of malevolently don't lack, especially, I guess, in the last, 18, 20 months now of kind of virtual performing and virtual listening. A lot of these kind of relational phatic things that you talk about, I was wondering where the location is. Is it that people need to be playing together? Is it that bodies need to be in the same room? Is it that even a relational thing can happen across time? Can we genuinely have a relational experience of music if we're listening to a recording? Does it matter what kind of a recording and how we're listening to it?
I think we always do, because what we hear is not just sound, it's traces of human behaviour. And we can allow that to happen in our heads. There's no particular real-world consequences, in a sense. But we are, again, never alone in our heads anyway, as humans. For whom is that internal monologue? And who's doing it, if I'm listening to it? One can ask these questions, but particularly with music, it's almost always traces of behaviour, traces of human behaviour, traces of human interaction that we're experiencing. So in a sense, it's rather like reading a novel, that one is making inferences about volition, intention, etc., which may or may not be warranted. But doing music or listening to music in company with others is a different thing, I think. Because when you're playing music in front of an audience, the audience is, in however small a way, part of the performance. You're often aware, is the audience interested? disengaged, enthralled. And it's difficult to predict when these things are going to happen. But you've probably been to concerts, been part of an audience, a performing group, where suddenly everything worked. It absolutely worked. And you're aware of that at the time, and that's almost all you're aware of. You don't have to do anything to do the music somehow. Then it finishes, and, oh, where was I? You were in a state of flow. Sometimes that happens in ways that engage both performers and audience. And those are extraordinary situations which are endowed with something that I don't think could emerge from listening to a recorded performance. There is now beginning to be some very interesting work done on the ways in which neural and physiological processes may be coupled across an audience in the course of a performance, and the ways in which, for instance, neural processes might be coupled between an audience and performer. It's difficult stuff to do, and it is just beginning to happen, but it does suggest that something can happen in live performances that doesn't happen in listening to recorded performances. Partly because in live performances there is a real-world interactivity, which there can never be with recorded performance. This is something that's happening irrespective of what you do. In a live concert, the audience is there. The audience can impinge on the consciousness and the actions of the performers. There is a degree of interaction going on. And that, I think, is what distinguishes the live from the recorded. Hence, in respect of current manifestations of music, where there's a tendency to say, oh, well, the recording will do, we've got the recording, we don't need the musicians. Well, in some respects, we don't need the musicians, economically speaking. There was a report the other day that indicated that I think 9 out of 10 musicians working in the UK earn less than £1,000 a month. And it's pretty depressing. And that is something that's happened largely as a consequence of the pandemic. The government has made absolutely no attempt to engage with this issue whatsoever. And that is, yeah, what I would have expected, I'm afraid. Mm. Because music does tend to be thought of as indispensable entertainment. We don't really, it's nice to have, like, you know, gold effect flock wallpaper, for instance, that one might order for one's official residence. But we don't really need it. But I think we do need it. I think without it, we're not actually human.
I'm really conscious of the fact that, especially with the pandemic, but even before, I think the pandemic only accelerated trends that were already there. Probably one part of it is, you know, the kind of shrinking public sphere in which kind of communal music making can happen, the over commercialization of music, and also over specialization, I would even risk to say, that keeps the majority of people out of very, very specialized spaces where things can happen. So I was speaking earlier to someone who has done some writing about how chamber music doesn't really exist in the way that it was intended to exist, which is to say it doesn't exist in chambers anymore or in domestic spaces and in rooms and in kind of informal settings. What can be done is, I'm thinking about kind of obviously music education in schools, but that also seems like institutionalized, and perhaps I've heard this so much from people who've just been actively discouraged from being interested in music because of school music education. So what, how might we want to bring live music back against these trends of atomization and commercialization?
Outreach. These days, a professional musician has to go out of the concert hall. Has to get out, works in the concert hall, but has to get out of the concert hall into schools, other spaces. Has to perform for and with young people. This is not a new issue. It's something that's been going on for 40, 50 years. Having said that, a lot of the success of music outreach or even music educational activities rests on enthusiasm and skill. If you've got a really, really good music teacher, it's going to work. If they're given the resources, and if children are introduced to music in appropriate ways. So, for instance, I live in a village outside Cambridge, and about, must have been 20 years ago now, the head music teacher there took a group of the kids into here, actually, the Westroads Concert Hall, to a performance of by the Academy of Ancient Music, who were performing Vivaldi, and doing it in the way that it would have been done, standing up. It's a rock concert. These kids came back saying, can we have a rock ensemble? And they did. They actually, you know, they were motivated to do that because they'd seen it. So these things can happen. It's a question of building up the intrinsic motivation. And it's also a question of giving kids the opportunity. I started off playing piano age five, hated it because I've got quite small hands. Went through violin, which I hated because of the teacher, before finding guitar, which just fitted. I also ended up playing clarinet, which I also hated, but that was solely because one day in class they had a music teacher come in and said, we need a second clarinetist for the first orchestra. Yep, Cross, you're it. What? I had no relationship other than a purely, as it were, instrumental one with the clarinet. So, motivation and opportunity. But at least, you know, I ended up playing guitar, but I had the opportunity for piano, for violin, for clarinet. Could have tried any number of other instruments, as it turns out. How many children get that opportunity now? For a while I was senior treasurer of the University Brass Band, which is very active and very good. And doing a concert in Willingham Church to celebrate the uncovering of some medieval wall paintings, and suggested it might be a good idea to go to the local primary school and do a little, you know, outreach thing, masterclass. And that was absolutely fantastic. The children loved it, the band loved it, because they were treated like rock stars. And for most of the kids, and this is 8 miles outside Cambridge, for most of the kids, this is the first time they'd ever heard live music. Mm. You know, we are so spoiled in Cambridge. There's so much music going on within the university, colleges. How much of it gets out, even 8 miles into the countryside around Cambridge, which is where it needs to be? If we are serious about making music central to social life, then we've got to get out there and do it.
One last question, mm-hmm. To sum up. How can we, so when I say we, I mean kind of literary critics, historians, music historians, though I think that they would be already better at doing this. How might we engage with the kind of research that you do? So especially, again, thinking about kind of historical subjects, thinking about musical events and hearing and playing bodies that are no longer accessible to us.
Yep, a whole range of ways. I edited a journal called Music and Science, oddly enough. And a German colleague published a paper in there recently on the notion of the glorifying hymnic. And this was intended to try and address a facet of 19th century music, particularly, that seemed to embody or encapsulate aspects of awe, of the uncanny, of the beyond, the transcendental. And he was trying to identify facets of musical structure or construction that might relate to that, through looking at the ways in which the music was written about at the time and the ways in which the music could be understood in terms of its structures and dynamics. That, to me, I mean, it's happening already. Historians are, I mean, this guy's a historian. But he's using tools that are, at least in part, analogous to those used in the sciences, or methods used in the sciences, to get at and identify and come up with new ideas about music and its dynamic, its historical dynamics. So it's happening already, but it is a question of people talking to each other, largely, and often collaborating. And that's something that is happening a lot. And it's not just historians, it's particularly it's ethnomusicologists and anthropologists as well, because music has many manifestations. We tend to think of it very easily, tend to think of it as a Western tonal music of the common practice period, i.e. the last 250, 300 years. Well, there's a lot more music than that around. And that's, again, beginning to be addressed. At times, somewhat naively, but there are some very interesting studies that are exploring music beyond the bounds of weird cultures. Have you come across the weird notion?
No.
Western, educated, industrialized, rich, and democratic, weird societies.
That's really good.
Yeah.
Right. Wonderful. Thanks so much, Professor Cross.
You're very welcome.
For your time. Ian Cross is now Emeritus Professor of Music and Science at the University of Cambridge, having retired in 2021 as Director of the Centre for Music and Science, where he led a lively group of graduate students and postdoctoral researchers in exploring music, its materials, and its effect from a wide range of scientific perspectives. His early research helped set the agenda for the study of music cognition, and he has since published widely in the field of music and science, from the psychoacoustics of violins to the evolutionary roots of musicality. His recent research has followed two main tracks in focusing on exploring relationships between speech and music as interactive media, and on the effects of engagement in group musical activities on the capacity for empathy. He's an emeritus fellow of Wolfson College, Cambridge, and also a guitarist.